A few instructions before we begin. Attendees should fill the feedback form whose link will be posted later in the Q&A box. The link to join tomorrow's session will be mailed to you by today evening. Please note that certificates will be awarded only to participants who have attended both the sessions on both days and have submitted feedback for both the days. Thank you. Respected Principal Dr. Rishikesh Soman Sir, Vice Principal Dr. Suneni Parchure Ma'am, Honorable Speakers, Teachers, and my dear audience, a very good morning to one and all present here. I, Krutasha Ramanujia, compare for the day, warmly welcome you all to the two-day national webinar on Reshaping India Post-COVID-19, presented to you by the Department of Commerce, Symbiosis College of Arts and Commerce. Socrates had rightly quoted, "The secret of change is to focus all of your energy not on fighting the old, but on building the new." Today, the pandemic has left devastating, deep, and long-standing effects on economies around the world, with every society and industry experiencing a unique set of challenges. When the entire humanity finds itself in the midst of uncertainty and gradually adopts to the new normals for every aspect of our life, the efforts for revival become essential. As we enter the phase of revival, we are in need of radical reforms with intent, integrity, and transformation with intensity. This webinar aims at providing opportunity to listen to experts from different sectors in order to discuss, deliberate, and introspect on reforms in various sectors post-COVID-19. The webinar will give us an opportunity to understand how India shall re-emerge itself post-COVID-19 and what shall be our role in it. Firstly, before we begin, I would request our principal, Dr. Rishikesh Soman Sir, to address the audience.
Good morning, everybody. I welcome you all for this national webinar on reshaping India post-COVID-19. I must congratulate our department for organizing such webinar. It is for 2 days and we have got total 4 speakers. And I'm very happy that we have got excellent speakers who will be talking on different topics. We are going through the difficult time, and this is not just a cliched statement, but it is the reality. Though we have got unlocked, though we have got a kind of permission to conduct certain activities, we have to be very careful. And the overall setback that we have got, especially to our economy, that setback is the real matter of worry. And 4 different sectors that we will be discussing in these 2 days, the experts in that, they will be talking about the effect of this particular pandemic on these various sectors. And these are the representative sectors as such. However, we will be naturally drawing the conclusions on the basis of these things. We have been saying that, healthcare and education, these are the 2 sectors. They were being neglected so far, or, the enough provisions were not being made. And that is getting proved, actually speaking. I mean, in today's world, in such kind of difficult situation, these are the 2 sectors which are of utmost necessary, which are of great importance, are not really, that they are struggling, they are trying to cope up, but they are struggling. They could have been more strong, they could have been much, capable of handling such kind of things in a more empowered way as such. We have got these setbacks in, say, 2 format. One is recoverable losses and irrecoverable losses. Now, certain industries which have got this kind of dent, and that is recoverable. That means maybe today they are suffering, but maybe over a period of time they will be able to recover that thing. However, tourism is one industry, or similar such industry which are what we call as time sensitive or time related perishable services, where this kind of recovery is absolutely not possible. A particular hotel room night that is gone. I mean, you cannot really recover that kind of revenue. And therefore, tourism becomes a very, very important area, which is actually having a great potential for earning good amount of foreign currency for our country. It has got a lot of cultural and historical angle. And again, just like education and health care, even tourism is being neglected over a period of time in our country. Though we have got huge potential, we have not really been able to capitalize on tourism. And in this particular pandemic, I believe the worldwide, I mean, not just in our country, worldwide tourism industry has suffered. And when I'm talking about tourism industry, it includes everything. That is, it is transportation, it is hospitality, it is food, it is entertainment, recreation, everything, really speaking. And that is a really, really troublesome thing, because recovering from such kind of losses is a real difficult part on the tourism industry, and it will take a lot of time to actually revive. So I think we have got an expert to talk on this particular topic today, and we will be able to get some more details on this kind of this particular sector from his speech. So I once again welcome all our speakers. I congratulate my colleagues Dr. Yogini Chiplunkar and Dr. Shobhada Tamankar, my network duo Nazir and Nitin, and my dear students, volunteers who have been a kind of integral part of this particular preparations and presentation. So I once again welcome you all, and I congratulate my team, and I wish all the success to this particular webinar, and hereby I declare the webinar open. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your motivating and informative words. It is now my honor to welcome our very first speaker for the day, Mr. Sering Wange, the founder and CEO of Himalayan Holidays, Arunachal Pradesh, and the Vice President of Northeast India Tourism Confederation. Sir has been promoting eco and adventure tourism within India and abroad for the past two decades, having obtained government registration in the year 1995 and tourism department recognition in the year 2000. He was the first Indian to do the world's highest sky jump. Sir has the distinction of making Northeast India tourism presentation in cities like New York, London, Amsterdam, and Singapore at the Ministry of Tourism, Government of India. Sir has been invited and appraised by the President of India, Ramnath Kovind ji, and our Honorable Prime Minister, Sri Narendra Modi ji, and Her Highness, the Queen Mother of Bhutan, Wangmo Wangchuk. In recognition of his efforts and contributions, he has been the proud recipient of many awards, namely the International Tourism Award, National Adventure Tourism Award, Bharat Excellence Award, Jewel of India Gold Award, and a certificate from the Ministry of Tourism, Government of India. He has produced popular travel series on the Northeast India tourist circuit for Indian Holidays Sony TV and for Wanderlust DD2. And also has worked closely under the Bollywood movie Koyla. Under Sir's leadership, Youth to the Edge, an adventure training program was organized. Today, he's going to enlighten us on the future of tourism post-COVID-19 and what would be the road ahead. Audience can simultaneously post questions in the Q&A box, which will be answered later in the Q&A session. We warmly welcome you, sir, and I kindly request you to take over now.
Honorable Dr. Rishikesh Soman, sir, respected guests, learned professors, invitees, and dear friends. Namaste, Tashi Dilek, and a very good morning to all of you. Well, I hope I'm audible. Okay, this said, I'm Sering Wange from Bomdila, Arunachal Pradesh. I come from a very small but beautiful town located near Indochina border town. Now, going by my name, I think it's very difficult for many of you to pronounce my name and also my face and the dress. Well, I'm neither a Bhutanese nor a Chinese. I'm very much Indian. मैं हिंदी बोल भी सकता हूँ और मैं हिंदी लिख भी सकता हूँ. वेल इनफैक्ट आई होल्ड इंडियन पासपोर्ट एंड नॉट वन बट सेवन पासपोर्ट्स. ओके, नाउ यू मस्ट बी थिंकिंग हाउ कम सेवन पासपोर्ट्स. Well, all my passports are filled with visas and immigration stamps from 48 different countries and regions around the world. I've traveled to these countries to promote travel and tourism and to participate in different fairs and festivals, workshops, tourism conferences, and exhibitions, and mostly to promote North East India tourism in the world market. If it was not for the COVID-19 situation, right now I would have been, you know, standing and talking to you in the you know, grand auditorium of Symbiosis College, Pune. Nevertheless, this modern technology has enabled us to reach out to each other through the virtual platform. Yes, this virtual platform, the online sessions, and the work from home is the new normal. And I know most of you will agree with me. And now I'll be sharing a PPT on reshaping India post COVID-19. And my topic is the future of tourism. As the moderator has already said, if you have any question, then you can write it down in the chat box, or the same can be discussed during the question answer session. So I'll start my PPT now. Okay, I was talking to you all about the new normal post COVID-19. So I'm taking you to the future. Just imagine 1 year or 2 years from today, what will be the office like? So mostly the meetings will be held in office days and the work will be done at home. Only for the important meetings, we will be going to the office. You see, the face-to-face interactive meetings with the colleagues, but all at a safe distance. It is because meeting people in real life produces better results than seeing each other. And as I told you, it will be mostly like work from home. Okay, so our future will be totally different from what it is now. And even when you go out from your house, when you're going to the market or shopping complex or to any office, the first thing that you will get to meet in the entrance will be, of course, the thermal body scanner to check your temperature. These are all going to be the new normal post COVID-19. And of course, a camera used for the facial recognition identifies the member and the security barrier opens. In many of the high-end offices, you'll find this type of new, contactless pathways to entry towards your office or to your workplace. And you see, most of the lifts will become voice activated because of the touchless technology. You'll find less of the buttons, and also the number of the people in the lift will be restricted to two. And also you all are well aware about the hand sanitizer. This will all become automatic. You'll be using automatic hand sanitizer machines in most of the places in future. And offices, we all have our office and we have our employees. We have our, so many people coming to our office also. So hereafter, we will have a partitioned rooms or cabins or area of work, which will have, plants or screens which are movable and adjustable. This will all be the part of the new norms. And in most of the AC offices, we'll have this air conditioning, which will directly kill the pathogens and the virus and the bacteria. So it will all be very, very latest technology which we'll be using in near future. Now, major changes. Major changes which is going to take place. This is like a financial pressure to change, shift away from the city, then making the home work, the rise of touchless technology, which I have just mentioned, the shape of things to come, and can open plant survive? So all these things are the major changes which is going to take place in near future. Since my topic is tourism, I will continue with this some data which we got it from UNWTO. So this is the impact of the COVID-19 on tourism in Q1, that is up to March, Jan to March. Now you see what was the impact. It was huge. 67 million fewer international tourist arrivals, and also the export revenue from the tourism lost in terms of $80 billion. Okay, and also 100% destinations with travel restrictions. All the destinations, whether it's in India or abroad, anywhere in the world, there's lot of restrictions in travel. Now this is a summary of the potential impacts which is going to happen in remaining months of the 2020. This is also as per the UNWTO. So this is the 850 million to 1.5 billion fewer international tourist arrivals will be there. So it's really huge. And also the US $910 billion to US $1.2 trillion loss will be in terms of from tourism exports. This is the revenue loss which is going to be potential impact in 2020. And now you see many of the jobs are being lost, companies are being going bankrupt, and so if we see the tourism jobs at risk, it is 100 to 120 million direct tourism job losses. You can see, you can feel it here in India, even in Northeast, in every part of the world. Actually, this has been the impact. Now, when we talk about tourism going to happen in near future, earlier, most of the people, like, they were going for the Western type of tourism because of the finance, technology, lifestyle, governance, glamour, resources, and education. But I feel, and I strongly have a feeling, that this Western tourism will turn towards Oriental type of tourism, which is like spirituality, nature, health, culture, civilization, of course, bounty of resources and variety. It's all because of people. They want to have yoga, they want to do this meditation, and of course they want to try the spirituality, and they are looking for the health and wellness tourism. So they are this tourism is turning towards the Oriental side, and this is going to be, I think, is going to go on for quite some time. Now if we do the SWOT analysis of the tourism as an industry, these are some of the challenges and opportunities. I'm talking about the internal factors. When you talk about the internal factors, the strength that we have are, of course, the proven resilience of tourism in past crisis, and our domestic tourism can be a buffer. Yes, everybody agrees that domestic tourism can be a buffer, and it's going to be the in thing for quite some time. Then adaptation capacity. Safety and hygiene protocols, trips closer to the home, value for money, responsible consumer behavior, and of course government support to the sector, and natural beauty, rich culture and heritage, unique traditions, and geographical diversity. So basically class tourism is going to be the strength. And when we look at the weaknesses, when we look at the negative part, we have this in segments potentially affected are also high spenders, like international long haul business and events. These are going to be affected, which are high spenders. And airline industry, it's really the major disruption. All airlines industry are facing huge problem. Then lack of network and synergy among public and private organization. Because of the COVID, there's a lot of problem happening. And so these are our weaknesses. And of course, perception of travel as a risk. Now people take travel as a risk. They don't want to travel much. They want to restrict travel as much as possible. And of course, low levels of demand when restarting tourism due to social distancing and SOPs. So many states, different regions, they have different SOPs and social distancing. These are keeping the demands low. And starting of tourism will take some time. When they look at the external factor, when we look at the external factor, these are the positive opportunities we can think of. Yes, rethink tourism model. We have to totally change the model of business now. And also we have to be innovative, and digitalization will have to be followed. If they don't follow this innovation and digitalization, then business is not going to happen. So these are the opportunities which we have. Of course, the sustainability and the sustainable oriented segments like rural, nature, health, these are our opportunities. Then of course, we have progress in adaptation plans and destination and companies. We have to adapt to the new destinations and new ways. And also the potential for the private sector in tourism projects. So there's a lot of a huge potential for private sector investment and community engagement in tourism. Because without community engagement, without the receptive community, I think tourism cannot happen. So we need to have awareness among the community, and they should be receptive. And of course, these are our opportunities I would like to share. And when we talk about the threats and the negative points, of course, the economic environment, there's a world recession is happening, and rising unemployment and job at risk, and several business which have closed down, and disposable income is also being affected, and business confidence is also being affected to a great extent. And yes, this pandemic, this uncertain length of pandemic and vaccine unavailability, so many people, so many scientists, so many countries, they are trying their best. But till now, I think we haven't got the vaccine yet. So these are the threats which we have to see. Then, of course, the extent of lockdowns and travel restrictions. Every second day, third day, these lockdowns happen. And there's the travel restrictions. There are new SOPs coming up. And so these things are all threats. Then, of course, the unknown form of the new normal. So people are yet to adjust to the new normal, and lack of technological infrastructure. So we really have to move fast with the technology, with the latest infrastructure technology. And these are the threats which I feel is very, very important. Now, how can we develop tourism in the present scenario? Because in India, the total perception of tourism, which we used to feel, we used to do, we used to follow, has changed totally in the last 4 or 5 months. But I personally see that I think domestic tourism is the way forward. And here I would like to share with you some of the government and stakeholders' initiatives. You see, there's the Ek Bharat Shrestha Bharat program of Government of India. Now, through this program, all the states are being linked and touched. Like, for example, Arunachal Pradesh is paired with Uttar Pradesh and Meghalaya. So we have conducted a program called Ek Bharat Shrestha Bharat program, where we three states, experts from these three states, we got together, organized a webinar, and gave our inputs. Likewise, Government of India, Ministry of Tourism has got Dekho Apna Desh. So to promote domestic tourism, this is a very good initiative, initiated by the Ministry of Tourism. So since outbound inbound tourism is not going to happen soon, so we have to, see our own states. So India is so huge, so big, so diverse. So first, let us see our own country. I myself have seen all the 7 states of Northeast and almost every states of India. So I think all of us should see our India first And then MOT workshops on travel and tourism. They are doing quite a few workshops on travel and tourism, and private entrepreneurs, private organizations, private Adventure Tour Operator Association of India, like other Northeast India Tourism Confederation, then Adventure Tour Operator Association, like that. They also organize different travel and tourism workshops, which is actually good, which will promote tourism and bring awareness. Then LTC, this is actually Government of India is giving some special concessions to the people to travel to the Northeast India and to certain regions like Ladakh and a few other select places where government refund the money to the tourist, you know, to visit these off-peak destinations. This is a very good initiative of the Government of India, and I'm sure they will continue with this program so that domestic tourism can flourish. The other program initiative by the Ministry of Tourism, which I'm associated with, is IITFC. This program will actually help our guides, our tourism stakeholders, to get trained under the Ministry of Tourism. It's completely online, and from home you can learn and you get certificate. And then this domestic tourism can flourish in very remote areas, because then they can take the help, they can take the advantage of the certified tourist guides at the remote locations. I would also like to talk about NIMAS. It's a National Institute of Mountaineering and Allied Sports. This is located in Arunachal Pradesh in a place called Dirang. And this institute, especially trains the people who are into adventure, land, air, and water. Right now, the whole of India is almost closed, but NIMAS is conducting, a mountain expeditions in the remote Arunachal Himalayas. So they have not stopped. They are doing, and they are training hundreds of youths from all over India in different type of adventure activities. Then of course the rural and village travel awareness and receptiveness, which I said, is very important to promote tourism, domestic tourism. Because if you bring tourists, and if our tourists are not allowed in the villages, if they are not allowed in the rural areas, then how can we promote tourism? So we have to, the government have to, the stakeholders have to educate the rural and village people, and tell them the safety and about the whole domestic tourism, and bring them in our make them receptive to the domestic tourism. And of course, tourism friendly policy. Without government framing a tourism friendly policy, we cannot do much. So I think all the tourism organizations, they have been of course appealing to the government to frame tourism friendly policies. So I think this is a very, very important sector to move our tourism industry in the right way. Since I am from the Northeast, I would like to give a little bit of tourism that is going to happen in the Northeast India. Well, many of you may not be knowing much about Northeast India, so I'll just give a brief about it. Northeast India comprises of Arunachal Pradesh, Assam, Sikkim, Nagaland, Mizoram, Meghalaya, Tripura, and Manipur. So it is full of blue mountains, snow-clad lakes, and green valleys, and beautiful and natural beauty. And it is, of course, very less explored, and you can have unique experiences in Northeast India. Now, coming to Arunachal Pradesh, this is the photograph of Tawang Monastery. The name is Tawang Galden Namgyal Latse Monastery, popularly known as Tawang Monastery. This is the second largest monastery in Asia and the first largest in India. And this is, so important from tourism point of view, that people from all over India and abroad, they come and visit. It is like Taj Mahal of Agra. So when you come to Arunachal Pradesh, you must make it a point to visit Tawang. And I would like to add one more place, Dong. I do not know how many of you have heard about Dong. It's a small, beautiful valley. The sun rises first in the Dong Valley in Arunachal Pradesh. So I think you all can plan for this beautiful trip to Arunachal Pradesh. There are a lot more, but I will stick to just these two points. Now, if you see this beautiful, island, actually, it's a big island. It's the world's biggest river island, inhabited river island in the world. And it is located in our beautiful, awesome Assam. Okay, and people come here, and then there it's a different world altogether, with rich culture and a lot of things to do and feel. And I think you must visit Northeast, and you must make it a point to visit Majuli. Of course, Kaziranga National Park, which is a world famous as a World Heritage Site of Assam, is another big attraction, and there are many more. So just these two is more than sufficient to bring you to Assam, and especially tea tourism, you will love it. Everywhere in the world they drink tea. Most of the tea comes from our beautiful, awesome Assam. Now, if you see this, some of you must be thinking, what is this? Just look at it very nicely. You will observe that these are actually roots. Okay, it's the roots of the tree, and this has been made into a bridge. So this is in fact a double-decker bridge. This is a very famous tourist destination in Meghalaya. You'll find several route bridges in Meghalaya, but this is double-decker bridge, which you'll find only in a place called Nongret Cherrapunji. If you have to come here to see the beauty for yourself, okay? And Cherrapunji, of course, you must have heard, it is the world's heaviest rainfall happens here. And Meghalaya is really, really beautiful, and travel restrictions are not much, and people are very friendly, and you all will love Meghalaya, especially the capital Shillong. It's really the hub where the modern music is the capital of the music in India. So next is Manipur. Now you will see some small houses and some boats. This is actually a village, a floating village. This is a floating village in Loktak Lake. It is in Manipur, not very far from Imphal, the capital city of Manipur. You see these houses, this whole village, they float on the lake. The lake is so beautiful. If you see from when you come to Manipur and from the flight, when you see down, it is amazing. It's amazing. It's really different type of world. Sometimes a very funny thing happens, like the postman have to deliver some letters. They cannot find the house because the house keeps on moving from this end to another end. So I mean, this is very interesting, and there are beautiful homestay. You all can come and visit. It is really, really a lifetime experience. You must come and see. Of course, Manipur is again famous. Marycom, you must have heard. Okay, so this is the state where Marycom comes from, and of course, the Shanghai deer, and there are so many things in Manipur. One more thing that I would like to tell you about Manipur is about the War Museum. Okay, so many tourists from UK and Japan, they come, and this I think you should visit to see it for yourself. Now, another very interesting thing you'll find about Mizoram. I do not know how many of you have heard about Mizoram. It's a tiny but very, very beautiful state of in Northeast India. Now you will find this, some packets. These are all, this is actually a shop. You can call it a wayside amenities, and people buy these goods. But the most interesting thing is that there's no shop owner. All these shops are there, and the goodies are there, and the money box is there, cash box is there. Even there's a two small pouches for the change, but you will not find any owner. What you have to do is, if you're passing through the streets, if you're going to Champa, Lungle, or Ajwal, on the highway, you'll find this very, very interesting shops. No owners. What you have to do is, you go, you pick up whatever you want, the price is mentioned there, and you put the money in the box. Okay? And if you don't have change, you collect the change from that pouch, and then you move away. nobody steals, nobody takes away anything, and this is normal. It is everyday life, but I don't know if you will find like this anywhere in the world. It's unique to Mizoram, okay? And another thing is that you'll find again some more, pineapples kept on platforms, free of cost. Anybody who wants to pick up, they can pick up free of cost. Such things are happening in Mizoram. So this is a very unique things, and you'll not find anywhere in the world that you can see the integrity. And also, you see, if you in Mizoram, traffic, you have to come and see the traffic, in Mizoram. I'm not able to show you the photograph right now, but some other time I will show you the photograph. It's nobody in the world follows the traffic rule like it is done in Mizoram. And they are also very good in paragliding. They have done two international paragliding events, and they are very good. And next, you will see Nagaland. Many of you must have heard about the Hornbill Festival. Okay, people from all over the world come for the Hornbill Festival. And yesterday I had a talk with our friends in Nagaland, and they said that Hornbill Festival is going to happen this year also. COVID-19 or no COVID-19, Hornbill Festival is going to happen. Even if required, they will do it digitally, but they will do it. And it's the biggest crowd pulling event of Nagaland. And Nagaland, of course, there are so many more things, but I will restrict it to just a few points. And coming to Sikkim, I know many of you must have visited Sikkim, and you must have seen Kanchenjunga from a very close range. And it is the third highest mountain in the world, and of course the first highest mountain in India. Okay, and it is also the UNESCO hot biodiversity place where culture and Sikkim, I won't say much because most of you know about it. So now I'll move on to Tripura. So you see this Nir Mahal, it's so beautiful, so big, and so beautiful, it is the largest water palace in India. And next to the you'll also see the night vision and also the day photograph, which is so beautiful. If you take a normal camera and you want to take the picture, you cannot take the full shot. You have to go 800 meters far away from the main gate to get the complete. It is so huge. Okay, it's so beautiful. You must visit Tripura to see all this. And another, important destination is Uni Kuti. So you must visit those places as well. Okay, notice India has the biggest opportunities. Why I'm saying this is because most of the states in Northeast have got comparatively less COVID-19 cases. Okay, and of course it is less crowded, and it's having an organic lifestyle. And the whole atmosphere is very healing. You get a spiritual feeling. The culture is rich. And of course, it is unexplored. Not many tourists you'll find. Okay. So you will find similar to such states in Ladakh also, Himachal also, and also other major places in India. So what I'm trying to say is that domestic tourism can happen, and this notice India and Ladakh and places where less COVID cases are there, less crowded, organic lifestyle, healing atmosphere, and less explored places. This will be the places where tourism will have a massive impact, and it will be the it will bring this one. Now I will take you to the route of recovery. As per the Secretary General of UNWTO, the trust is the new currency of new normal, and tourism is ideally positioned to be the vehicle to channel trust. So what is trust? Why he is emphasizing so much on the trust? So these are the route to the recovery, and since no inbound and outbound tourism is going to happen anytime soon, so as I said again and again, tourism, domestic tourism, is the way ahead. And safe and seamless of border management that has to be taken care of by the government, including ERC and water travel has to be taken care of. and immunity passports. So whoever visits the countries, they must have COVID-free certificates. Most countries will demand this, and people should have this one. And of course, MICE, meeting incentives, conferences, and exhibitions. These are all the route to the recovery, and the destination planning, management. And of course, without tour operators and travel agencies, things are not going to move ahead. I tell you, because tour operators and travel agencies help, assistance, cooperation, and their this one initiation is very, very important. And of course, we have to identify the green zones and hospitality, of course, which is also part of the tour operators and travel agencies. This all are on the route towards the recovery. Now, reinventing business modules. Since the whole dynamic of business has changed, so we have to think about how to reinvent, how to do business. Now, you say ecotourism, yoga and wellness retreats, destination weddings, gastronomic tourism, culinary tourism, which you call, and also the adventure activities and agritourism. Now, these are the things which is going to be the in thing. So we have to focus on ecotourism. We have to focus on the yoga and wellness retreats. We have to focus on the destination weddings and gastronomy tourism and adventure activities and agritourism. Okay, so these are the things which we have to think about. Now, again, there are a few new concepts which we have to incorporate. That is like expat tourism, quarantine tourism, and slow tourism. So when you talk about expat tourism, it's totally a new concept. Many of you must be thinking, "Ye hota kya hai expat tourism? Hota kya hai?" So it actually refers to the term of the highly skilled employees of a multinational corporation living temporarily or permanently somewhere other than their own native country or region or area. Say myself, I want to, go to another place, and I'm sitting in. I'm from a city. So if I go to another very calm and quiet village, but I can do at the same time work also. So I'm doing on a vacation, but at the same time I'm working. So many multinational corporations or multinational companies, they can send their executives on this type of expat tourism. Now this is another quarantine tourism, which is again totally a new concept. Of course, many people must be knowing about it, but I think you should and you must also do this quarantine tourism. Like Goa started quarantine tourism, but again when their COVID cases increased, so they stopped it. But in our place in Northeast, I think quarantine tourism can happen and people will come. Because you see, people who are staying in COVID active regions, they can go to the less COVID active regions, and then while having a vacation, they can also enjoy and work as well. And another new concept is slow travel. Now, what is this art of the slow travel? Now, this is connecting with the local people, trying traditional food, discovering local traditions, immersing oneself in the destination, transforming a simple holiday into a life-changing trip. This all things comes under slow travel. You can say this one is like village and rural tourism. Now this is another part of slow travel is WOOF. Okay, worldwide opportunities on organic farms. Or willing workers on organic farms is a loose network of national organizations that facilitate homestays on organic farms. Well, is this basically a form of homestay tourism whereby the tourists work on the farm in exchange for a free board? So this is the new type of tourism which people can experience, enjoy, and have some fun terms. Now coming to the things to remember, urbanization is no more necessary you don't have to sit in the city. You can work anywhere from anywhere. You can stay in the village also. You can stay from your home and work. So like earlier, we must go to the office. No, that thing has changed. And mass tourism will have to be avoided. No more mass tourism. People will have to go for the class tourism. And people with less number of people traveling together. Sorry. I would like to have a glass of water. Sorry. As I told you, branding is a top priority. And trust, as I already told you, is the new currency. And health and hygiene standards will have to maintain at any cost. If you don't follow health and hygiene standards, then things are going to be problematic. Now, be future ready. Okay. So now this is about you have to be future ready. Like with the market research, you have to do the digital marketing and also the virtual tourism. You have to do the destination image creation and also destination branding, basic healthcare facilities, artificial intelligence. I hope I have a few more minutes to go. Time.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I'm coming to the end of my PPT. Okay. So because there were some sounds coming up, so I thought maybe my time is up. That's why I got so engrossed in my PPT. So thank you very much. This is the end of my PowerPoint presentation. And if there's any questions, we can discuss during the question answer session. And now over to the moderator. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your informative words, for putting light on various sectors of tourism and related to tourism, for giving us the beautiful small tour of the Northeast countries. And now I would like to move ahead to the question answer session. We have only selected few questions due to lack of time. So the first question is from Janu Borua. And the question is, how do we have to prepare to stand as an entrepreneur post COVID-19?
Can you repeat the question, please?
So the question is, how do we have to prepare to stand as an entrepreneur post COVID-19?
Okay. Fine. As I have given in my presentation, total scenario is going to be changed. Okay, to be an entrepreneur and how to be ready for the new situation. Okay, so you must refer to my PPT and you must get ready with the new digitalization. Okay, and also you must be ready with the new SOPs and also the new norms which are being set by the government from time to time. And you have to totally, devote your time and energy in promoting domestic tourism, at least for the next 1 year or so. You should forget about the international traffic for the timing. As a tourism entrepreneur, you should, I think, emphasize on online. You try to skill yourself in you see this, what is this called, how to promote your destinations or your itineraries. So you have to go online and social, so you have to do social promotions, and there are so many courses happening, so you have to skill yourself. Basically, that's what I'm trying to tell you. And don't lose hope. Focus. Don't think too many things. Just focus on your how to improve, how to sell, and how to survive. Once you are able to survive, then of course you can thrive. Okay. So these are the basic things which you need to do to survive in the tourism as an entrepreneur. I hope I'm able to, you know, tell you and I'm able to reply to your questions. Okay, ma'am, can I have the next question, please?
Yes, sir. The next question is, what is the future of rural homestays and how can we make the home ready for a homestay?
What is the future of?
Rural homestays. What is the future of rural homestays and how can we make the home ready for a homestay?
Okay, this is a very good question, I would say, because the new norms demands that we restrict our tourism activities to the rural areas and also to the mostly to the rural areas means what? Homestay, obviously. No, we are not emphasizing on big hotels, five-star hotels, or nothing like that. We are all emphasizing on the rural areas with the homestay. So, future, I would say, is bright. Right now, we are all going through a very tough times, and some of us have lost hope. Some of us are facing great financial problems. The loans taken are unable to be repaid. So how do we survive and how do we thrive? Okay, so here I think number one is you must meet your local administration, the local government bodies, and also the tourism department, and ask for the, you know, guidelines, ask for the government assistance. There are so many loans and financial packages being announced by the government of India through SME department, through Ministry of Tourism, and routed through the banks. So for financial help, you must go to them and get it refinanced or get your financial rearrangements done so that you can at least survive for next few months. And of course, other than that, the government is giving some, you know, homestay training and how to manage the homestay, and also you know, as I told you, IITF program. So those type of trainings you have to undertake, and I'm sure this homestay thing, this is going to, you know, prosper and is going to thrive in near future, and this is the way out. So don't lose heart, just stay focused, work hard, and you know, the tourism will happen, and tourism will happen if not sooner then at least in next few months it is going to restart with at least domestic tourism. So don't lose out and keep working towards your property and towards your homestay entrepreneurship. Okay, yeah,
thank
can I
you,
have
sir.
Next question, please.
So, due to paucity of time, only two questions are taken.
Okay.
So, thank you, sir. It was a pleasure having you on our platform. Do you want to say anything else to the audience?
Yes. I would, of course, like to, first, I would like to thank Principal Sir, Rishikesh Sir, and also all the professors and coordinators for giving me this opportunity and for this platform, and I do not know how much justice I've been able to do it, but I really thank the organizers for this type of program. I'm sure many of our friends who are attending will be benefited from this program, and especially our students and our youths, just keep yourself healthy, safe, strong, and don't lose heart. Pandemic time will go away and good times will come. Okay, so don't lose heart, do some yoga, do some exercise, and keep safe, keep healthy, and this tourism thing will happen, and we all will survive these hard times, and we all will thrive, and we all will enjoy and have a good life ahead. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Moving ahead, first, I would like to repeat a few instructions. Kindly fill up the feedback form, which will later be posted in the Q&A box in the published section. The link to join tomorrow's session will be mailed to you by today evening. Please note that certificates will be awarded only to those participants who have attended both the sessions on both days and have submitted feedback for both the days. With this, we move forward to our next session for the day. Our next honorable speaker is Dr. Srikant Paranjpe. Sir is currently a research fellow at the Center for Military Studies, faculty at the Department of Military Science at Stellenbosch University, South Africa, and a former honorary adjunct professor in the Department of Defense and Strategic Studies, SPPU. Sir has been the Jawaharlal Nehru National Fellow of the Indian Council for Social Science Research, Professor in the Department of Defense and Strategic Studies and Director at the Yashwant Rao Chavan National Center of International Security and Defense Analysis, SPPU. He was a Fulbright Fellow at the George Washington University, Washington, D.C., and a visiting professor at Colorado College, Colorado Springs. Sir is also an academic advisor at MIT Pune for School of Government, a program that seeks to train the Indian youth into social and political leadership. He has published several books and articles in the area of security studies and international relations. Sir will be sharing his thoughts on post-COVID world order and India. Again, audience can simultaneously post questions in the Q&A box, which will be later answered in the Q&A session. With this, I warmly welcome you, sir, and I request you to take over the platform. Thank you.
Okay, so should I begin?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Morning, everybody. What I plan to do today is to basically talk about what is looked at as the post-COVID or post-corona world order and where India stands in this world order. Let me begin first by thanking the Symbiosis College of Arts and Commerce for inviting me here to share some of my ideas, some of my views about this. I do not expect that all of you would really agree with almost everything that I say. Feel free to raise objections, questions, counters, or whatever. Let me begin by saying that when you're looking at what is described as a post-COVID world order, I have no intentions of making any predictions. It would be very difficult to really make predictions about the nature of the world order in the future. A lot of things are in the flux. A lot of things are still changing. We are into what is now called a new normal. So what I'm really trying to do is basically spell out some of the trends which I perceive to be the trends that one would see as the world evolves in this post-pandemic kind of a situation. And also, while I'm talking, in fact, I'll be talking of it in two parts. One is when I'm looking at the world in general and looking at the whole perspective of how things are changing around, that is one part. And second is when I'm saying that where does India stand in all of this? Where do we stand and what are the issues that are likely to face us? That would be the second part of what I would be saying. Let me start with certain trends that I would eventually highlight. I would initially flag certain trends which I would argue trends which would be dominant in this post-COVID world order. What kind of trends am I talking of? One trend that I'm talking of is the increasing role of technology. What we are doing now is essentially high tech, but to me, but I'll come to that in a moment. But increasing role of technology in the world at large. Second, I see a crisis in what are described as international organizations, regional organizations, whether functional or otherwise, crisis of legitimacy, crisis in terms of what is likely to take place in terms of challenges to these international organizations or regional organizations, and I'll spell that out in more detail eventually. The other aspect is the sense that you're likely to go into a phase of more active, I would not use the word militant necessarily, but more active nationalism. I'll spell that out as a third trend in due course. And in all of this, as three main trends, challenges, the fourth trend that I would eventually talk of is challenges to peace and security. And when I'm talking of peace and security, I'm not just talking in terms of a no war phenomenon, I'm talking of challenges to peace and security in a very broad sense, including issues of development. Challenges to peace and security are likely to come from different forms of conflict, what are now called hybrid warfare, or what are called different kinds of warfare, not traditional conflicts, but these are new challenges that are coming. Who are likely to be key players in these issues or on the front? The United States would continue to be a key player. China is likely to emerge as a key player. Russia would continue to dominate as a key player. These would be the three key players that would be really playing a major role. Along with this, there is a second level of key players that one can identify. One can identify India, one can identify Germany, or perhaps European Union, post-Brexit European Union. And third is Japan. I would not put Australia just now, but I would put Japan as a second layer of key players that are likely to play a significant role. These are trends, and I will go individually into each of them. But there's another aspect which I want to spell out. What are likely to be the drivers in the context of these trends? What are likely to be issues which would drive some of these key trends, change them, alter them, revise them, or whatever? One is people waiting for the American elections, presidential elections. Whether it would be the return of President Trump, or whether it would be a Democrat president, that is one key driver. Second is the nature of Brexit. How and in what manner does Brexit really take place? Total breakup or otherwise? Third is what happens to China, the direction that China is likely to take in the coming years. Direction in terms of, I shall come to that more detail later. And fourth is a continuing issue about the nature of terrorism, which is an important driver because that has something to do with nationalism also, and I'll come to that eventually. Let me start with the trends first. I'll come to India in due course. These trends would be what could be described as the post-COVID world order. Look at technology. You know, I'm tempted to make a side remark. When we talk of technology, I have always maintained that I'm a technologically challenged person. I remember very many years ago, not much in the distance past, when the mobile revolution took place in India, my son used to keep telling me that you need to buy a mobile. And I kept saying, I don't need it. Eventually, it was forced on me and I started to use it. Simple mobiles, smartphones and whatnot. the world has changed. Now almost everybody carries a mobile. It's a whole technological revolution. Any dialogue with those in the technological sector would usually focus, or which would usually start, in my case at least, and this is a side remark, we don't take it very seriously, would usually start with a comment that you really don't understand anything. Or if you want it in Marathi, Baba Tula Samjat Nahi. Having said that, look at the massive spread of technology that has taken place. You can call it Facebook revolution, you can call it social media revolution, you can call it internet revolution, the massive spread. At one time, it had a major role to play in the Arab Spring, for example. Today, it has a major role to play in a situation where you have a lockdown almost universally. You're talking of webinars, what I'm trying to do now. And your Symbosis technical team will tell you, perhaps, how difficult it has been to get me to load onto what I am now doing. Technologically challenged, as I say. But in any way, but my point is not that. My point is, technology is likely to be an important factor. And when I'm saying technology, it is not just the internet technology or internet revolution. I'm talking of all kinds of technology. I'm also talking of biosciences. I'm talking of life sciences. See, after all, what is the whole issue of COVID? What is the whole issue of the whole pandemic? Whether you're trying to create a vaccine or otherwise, you're essentially talking of biological issues. The traditional borders which existed in the area of technology, that this is pure physics, this is pure chemistry, this is pure biology, do not exist now. There's a whole intermingling of all of this. And the domination which technology is likely to play across the world is something which one must keep in mind as one of the key trends. Biotech, as I said, is an important phenomenon. Second, in terms of spelling out those trends, refers to the question of legitimacy which international organizations are now starting to face. Take a simple classic case, WHO, World Health Organization. The manner in which WHO behave, perhaps I'm using the wrong word, in the context of the COVID crisis when it started in China, one, and the way in which it delayed spelling out the intensity and problems and relied on a country to say that fine, it is good or bad or whatever. WHO came into crisis. See, when the American president questioned the WHO in terms of what it did or it did not do, there was a logic to it. There was a rationale to it. You might like President Trump, you might dislike President Trump, you might not like his policies, you may have a pathological kind of a resentment for him. But what the Americans were saying, what President Trump was saying about WHO was true. Whether you accept that taking an extreme step of getting out of WHO is good or bad is something different. That WHO needs to restructure itself is something which one has to accept. But that is one case and a classic case of how a regional or an international organization loses its legitimacy because of the way in which it acts. Same is in the case of United Nations, especially Security Council. A number of issues come up before the United Nations and they are either handled well or postponed or issues are simply flagged and nobody bothers about it. Regional organizations are the same. Regional organizations are increasingly becoming dominated by single powers. Or if they're not being dominated, they exit from it. Take NATO. Look at the way in which the Americans decided to tackle NATO. Essentially because the Americans were saying NATO was almost entirely funded by the Americans and the Europeans were not paying anything for the cost. So why should we pay for your security? Made sense at a level. Or look at SAARC, very much in South Asia. An excellent organization, it does not function at all, especially because of the intransitions of one country called Pakistan. My point is, regional organizations are getting into a crisis. European Union is in a crisis. See, with Brexit, people really do not know what is happening. What would be the exact nature of Brexit? They are still debating, they are still fighting, not just debating. The British Prime Minister is trying to negotiate something where he feels that he must have the cake and eat it too. The Europeans are trying to put pressure. Eventually, they'll come up with something perhaps, but it has led to a crisis. And European Union is a fantastic organization which is into crisis. But that is the second issue that I want to flag. Third issue is rise of nationalism. In some cases, militant nationalism. It does not begin with COVID, it actually begins much earlier. It began originally with, in the real sense, the modern form of more active nationalism, to me at least, began with the exodus or migration or illegal migration of people from West Asia, Syria or Iraq or whatever into Europe. And Europe started to close its borders. There was a sense of nationalism that grew within the European Union. Each country saying that we do not want migrants because they represent different kinds of dangers. Dangers from problems of assimilation on one hand to dangers of terrorism on the other. The height of all this was Brexit. One of the core issues why Britain wanted to get out of European Union is they do not want migrants from West Asia. If you look at America first, it is also assertion of nationalism. If you look at what is happening in Russia, in terms of Putin, it is assertion of Russian nationalism. If you look at China, in terms of what she is doing, it is assertion of Chinese nationalism. In India, we are also asserting Indian nationalism. The whole sense of nationalism and national identity is now coming to the fore. Logical question would be, does this counter or does this cut off the whole aspect of globalization as it had emerged? And my answer is no. So, when we talk of globalization, we do not just talk of integration in a very abstract sense. We talk of interdependence in terms of technology, interdependence in terms of the whole network of production and linkages which exist. You know, anything which is produced in a country, supply chains essentially, parts of it come from a variety of areas and they are assembled in one country. The whole aspect in terms of mindset that the whole world is different. All that continues to operate. At a psychological level, however, you still find there's a sense of nationalism. The conflict or the or the addressing of globalization on one hand and nationalism on the other, where will it really meet? It will meet essentially at a point where countries would say, these are the limits of globalization so far as my national interest is concerned. And the critical limits in almost every case are likely to be the economics of that country. It is likely to be the way in which the country is able to provide economic welfare, jobs for that country. You know, many years ago, if you remember or if you recall, President Clinton during his second running for being a president made a statement saying, it's the economy, stupid. Essentially arguing that what do you focus on when you're in elections? It's the economy. That is going to be the core of your electoral agenda. That is precisely what is it today. That's precisely what almost every country is doing in the context of nationalism, whether it is America first, whether it is India first, whether it is Russia first, whether what China is doing is doing. When you're looking at this, the argument is that the red lines of globalization impinging on nationalism will be drawn in terms of economic red lines. That is where nationalism will come in. And perhaps it will also come in terms of psychological or cultural aspects. Because culture of nationalism is also something which one has to look at. That is, look at some of the key players in terms of trends. United States, China, Russia. Americans are likely to dominate. They have a huge economy. And whether one likes it or not, as I said, one will be critical of Trump or one will not be critical of President Trump, American economy did revive during his tenure, or was able to revive during his tenure. Whether it is in terms of trade, whether it is in terms of getting manufacturing sector back into the United States, whether it is having a change done, implemented in reality to the North American Free Trade Agreement, Canada, United States, and Mexico. Essentially, Americans were on the rise. The whole trend of American economy going up, which President Trump was able to do successfully, perhaps was stalled because of the COVID-19 phenomenon. But they're likely to bounce back, and that is something which they have. The other aspect of the United States, which equally one must remember, is getting out of a variety of entanglements which President Trump feels are unnecessary. Whether it is withdrawing its troops from Europe, from West Asia, or getting countries to bear the costs of security and saying that we are not going to be policemen of the world anymore. One might agree with the Americans or not, but that is the kind of policy they make. That is America first. That does not mean that they'll go into isolation. They will dominate the world in any case, but that is United States. Look at Russia. It is a whole Putin age. Russia is not very much on the forefront in terms of media. Quiet. But you cannot write of Russia. It has a huge potential, it has a huge actual source of power. And whatever it is doing very quietly, putting sufficient pressure. So you cannot write of Russia. And increasingly, a very strong nationalist Russia will do something which you will see. Look at China. China, a couple of points here. China started to feel a crisis after the American trade war began. Chinese economy went into a crisis, it started to go into a crisis, it went into more crisis with the Wuhan COVID phenomenon. So economically, Chinese are struggling. They're struggling in terms of the industry, they're struggling in terms of their economic output, they're struggling in terms of their economic welfare. How are they countering that? And after all, one must remember, an average Chinese person would continue to support the authoritarian Chinese regime only to the extent that they are able to get something from the regime. If the regime stops providing the necessary welfare or benefits to them, there would be a reaction. Putin knows that very well. He's giving that to the Russians. How does China react to that? China is reacting in a very militant manner by talking about militant nationalism, by talking about threats from all over the world, and therefore we must enter a phase of militant nationalism. But it's a typical kind of a reaction which countries show. You talk of external threat and you get people together. And that external threat is talked of in terms of whether it is South China Sea, whether it is Japan, whether it is the United States, Indian borders and whatnot. That kind of a situation is something which is there. Now, one of the aspects about Chinese is the question of what is called wolf warriors. That is the new diplomacy which Chinese have initiated. Wolf warriors is a term which is peculiarly Chinese. Now, some of you might be seeing that, what Americans look at when they look at Rambo films, wolf warriors is similar to an American Rambo, but it is a Chinese brilliant. The Chinese have films on wolf, they have series, and the argument is very simple, that they are the ones who protect Chinese interests, protect Chinese people all over the world when there's a crisis. Typical American Rambo. That is the new form of diplomacy. Very aggressive. Gone are the days of Chuan Lai and gone are the days of Deng Xiaoping. Xi's diplomacy is aggressive diplomacy. It is that aggressive China that you are seeing. These are the kind of trends that I am talking about. I'm only highlighting, flagging those trends, not going into detail. I'll answer some of the questions if you have. But I talked of drivers. Let me spell that out and then come to India. I said, wait until the American elections. Why wait until the American elections? Because if you read papers, they'll tell you the Russians want Trump, the Chinese want the Democrats to win. So they're likely to use a variety of social networking sites to intervene, to create a kind of a situation where Americans are influenced. The argument is that if President Trump returns to power, the current American foreign policy would continue. An aggressive America first, aggressive anti-China, aggressive Middle Eastern phenomenon, West Asian phenomenon, aggressive policies so far as migration is concerned. But if he does not come to power and the Democrats win it, Joe Biden wins the election, he should be formally placed as the next contender. If he wins the election, then the feeling is that the Democrats would not be so aggressive. I have two takes on that. I might be entirely wrong. You might say you do not understand the United States quite rightly. I have two takes on that. One is that if the Democrats do come to power, I doubt if some of the foreign policy initiatives which President Trump has made would be changed. I'm not talking of WHO, that Biden has in any case announced that he will not withdraw. But I'm talking about China. I'm talking also of migration. On these issues, I doubt if the American policies would really change, whether it is Democrats or whether it is Republicans. That is one take. Second take, and I might be entirely wrong. You can laugh at me in November. I still feel that Trump has a very good chance of coming back. Essentially, the way in which, I mean, you might criticize the way in which he's handling post-COVID phenomena, but understand, whatever he talks, he's there on the front, leading from the front. Maybe you feel he's a bad leader, but he's leading from the front. And that is what people will remember, that here is a president who kept saying that this is what it is. And when the Congress does not work, it takes action. For example, what he did yesterday or today in terms of providing relief to people and unemployment benefits. But that is United States. As a second is nature of Brexit. There's a lot of uncertainty around it. European Union with Britain was a very strong organization. European Union minus Britain would have some handicaps. Handicaps would essentially be in terms of how you present yourself to the world. See, don't forget, European Union is a huge market. European Union, all those countries together, is a huge market. It is a huge complex. You're not dealing with one country and the axis which cuts across. You're dealing with an entire group, a region per se. If the Brexit takes place in a very tragic manner where Britain really gets out and has no trade links at all and goes back to what is looked at as a WTO logic, my feeling is Britain would suffer. They do not want to cut themselves out of trade totally, but they also, at the same time, want their identity to be kept intact. In any case, when they were within the European Union, they had always one leg outside. You know, the Queen, the Pound, they were not part of Schengen, for example. Now they are entirely getting out. The critical issues would be Ireland, what happens in Ireland. Critical issues would be Scotland, what happens in... See, when I'm talking of nationalism in this context, you find questions of Great Britain being raised in the context of nationalism. How does one look at Northern Ireland within United Kingdom? How does one look at Scotland within United Kingdom? Because Scotland never wanted to be out of the European Union. So these issues are likely to rankle, but that is one. Direction which China takes. There have been some indicators, small, but some indicators, which say that the kind of militant, aggressive nationalism which China is pursuing, this nationalism is likely to create problems for China. And there's some indicators of some realization coming within China. This has nothing to do with Hong Kong. Chinese will be very aggressive on Hong Kong. They do not want to give up on Hong Kong. This is essentially to do whether it would continue to pay dividends. You know, Chinese have what is described as checkbook diplomacy. What is checkbook diplomacy? They have been giving massive loans across the world, whether it is Latin America, whether it is Africa, whether it is Asia. These massive loans which have been given, when the loans are not repaid, how does China react in case of Sri Lanka, in case of the Hambantota port? They took over the port. No, classic East India Company phenomenon. Now, is it possible for China to continue to hold on to this massive investments outside when its economy is not really doing well? A classic case of our neighbor, Pakistan, the China-Pacific Economic Corridor, China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. The funding has gone down. There have been opposition within Pakistan, whether it is Baluchistan or whether it is other area, Northwest Frontier. How does China continue to maintain this economic presence when there's a crisis, at an economic crisis at the domestic level? So the trend which China might create, and that is an uncertainty, because the epidemic, the pandemic, has really created a crisis for China. Crisis which was multiplied because of the earlier American policies of trade wars. So how does one tackle that? Fourth driver, which I had made a mention of, was nature of terrorism. And that is where one talks of nature of warfare or modern kind of issues. Classical terrorism, which has emerged in the context of the Islamic State, ISIS, is still seen as something which exists. That has not died out. That has been on and off, sporadic in a number of places. We've seen that in Jammu and Kashmir, for example. We've seen that in other places, whether it is Syria, whether it is Iraq, whether it is areas in Africa, whether it is areas in Europe. That form of terrorism has not died, and that is likely to really continue for some time. Now, it is not a traditional form where you are fighting for your nation, national identity or regional identity or ethnic identity or fighting for people. Here you are fighting for abstract ideas, abstract religious cause, which does not know any boundary. It is transnational in that sense. So that is likely to continue. Let me come to the second part of what I am trying to say, India. Where does India locate itself in all of this? The most tempting question would be the current issue of China or the current issue of Pakistan. Let me say that when you're looking at the current issue of China or Pakistan, look at it at two levels. One is local and one is more global or regional. Tackling these situations in case of China at a local level is something which the Indian Armed Forces are doing, Indian government is doing. That is something which has been doing very systematically since the last few years, indicating to China that if force is being used, we are willing to use and we are ready to use counter force. And India has proved that, and India would not step back. The old age of appeasement is gone. We are doing the same in case of Pakistan. That old age of appeasement is gone. Use of force will be countered by counterforce. So at the local level, I'm not raising any question, I'm not talking about that. At a global level, or perhaps at a regional level, when you're looking at crisis situations, look beyond China and Pakistan. Look at the way in which India has been able to spread out its wings over the last few years. Not restrict itself to a notion of an ideological mindset, Let me spell out what I mean in terms of concrete terms. We continue to have good relations with the Russians. What has changed is the exclusivity which existed during the Soviet Union or the early years during Indo-Russian ties, that exclusivity has gone. And we are willing to say that there is a world beyond Russia. We are being realist in our approach. So we have an approach, open-ended approach with the Americans, with the French, Europeans in general. What began as Look East is now Act East. We are active in the Asia Pacific. Look at Quad, quadrilateral, India, Japan, Australia, and United States. We have given up an ideological mindset. If you are still worried about non-alignment, we talk about it. Perhaps only talk about it. Quiet, worry. But look at West Asia. Or Middle East, however you label it. We have developed excellent relations with the Arab world simultaneously with Israel. And we are able to balance both. It is not an accident that Pakistan is finding it difficult to have a meeting on Kashmir of the Islamic conference, where countries like Saudi Arabia are saying no to it. We also, despite the hitches that one might feel about Iran in terms of Chabahar port, we still have very good relations with Iran. And again, on a side remark, Chinese investments in Iran and Chinese investments in Pakistan have to be looked at in a very different manner. Iran is not Pakistan. Iran has a far more militant Islamic nationalism which can undercut Chinese policies, which Pakistan does not have. Pakistan's nationalism is restricted perhaps to its armed forces, in the interest of the armed forces, but that is not the issue. The real issue in terms of post-COVID India is not going to be external, it is going to be domestic. It is going to be domestic in the sense, what kind of India are we trying to build at a domestic level? So when you talk of Make in India, when you talk of Swachh Bharat or a variety of issues, Make in India or Atmanirbhar does not mean you go back to the age when you say you have an import substitution model of the Nehru years. No, that age is over. You're not talking of an India which is far more competent in terms of technology, in terms of science and technology, to become Atmanirbhar. But my point is, critically, one has to look at India in a domestic sense. At what level would India want to appear unified to the world at large? Is there not a need for creating some kind of a national consensus on critical issues of security, which are not just military security? They involve economic security, they involve political security, they involve socio-cultural security, they involve civilization security. They involve a variety of dimensions. The internal dissent is fine. I mean, democracy requires dissent. Nothing wrong in that. The question is the degrees of dissent and the extent to which you can take it. That is where the problem comes. Argument is very simple. At a domestic level, India would have to evolve its economy in a more systematic manner. It's technological, and in case of technology, again, this is a side comment, some of you might not like it. Indian technology has necessarily been a service sector technology. India has been able to create, to put it in different terms, technologists or technicians. What India requires is scientists. There's a fundamental difference. We've now started realizing that the whole creation of ICER, etc., is creation of scientists. So technology is critical, and technology not just service industry technology, our critical IT service industry. Economy. Need to have a far more, an economy is not just urban, infrastructure economy, agriculture also, a far more stress on economy. It's the economy stupid is not a just a saying, it is a reality. It is that which will determine how India will really emerge in the post-COVID world order. There's a resilience in India, that is not a problem. The sense of identity for Indians, it needs to translate in reality. And that is where one really would go in the long run. I think I've taken sufficient amount of time, I should keep time for questions. Let me thank you if you're listening very patiently. Thank you very much. And I think I'm open for questions.
Thank you, sir, for your inspiring and thought-provoking words. Now the platform is open for the question-answer session. Only a limited questions will be selected due to lack of time. So the very first question is from Neha Agashe ma'am. With India warming up to the idea of Indo-Pacific and the quadrilateral, will it be able to contain China?
It is not so much a question of containing China. It is essentially creating an alternative worldview or an alternative position for India in the Asia-Pacific or Indo-Pacific. So for a very long time, we looked at Australia as somebody with whom we should not talk, or Japan with assumed we are essentially socialist in terms of mindset. That we have changed. And we are willing to say that if you have to counter China, not contain China, I would use the word counter China, you really need to create an alternative perspective. And that alternative perspective is what? In the Indo-Pacific region. Remember, India has also had excellent relations with Vietnam or some of the Southeast Asian countries. So Quad will give an identity to India, saying that, well, if you have to counter China, there is a area from where we can counter China, and that is where Indo-Pacific is something that is there. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. The next question is, what would you say is the role of SAARC, the World Bank, the IMF and the UN in the current scenario and the agenda on their part for the new normal?
SAARC. SAARC is unfortunate. You know, the critical problem with SAARC is, can you create SAARC without Pakistan? Because there was an attempt to create SAARC within SAARC at one time, where the idea is that some critical issues which do not require the entire community to go through, for example, if it is a matter of water problems, India, Nepal and Bangladesh, three can sit together. If it is a matter of aspects in, say, the Andaman area, India, Sri Lanka and others can sit together. This idea was mooted, but it didn't really take shape. SAARC tried to have its free trade, its preferential trade. There have been limitations to that. And the essential limitations are the political mindsets of almost all countries. They're also interdependent in a very different sense. And there's a fear of Indian domination. SAARC is theoretically good. At one time, some of us had worked on an idea of called SAARC Parliament, where you create a parliament, not in a traditional sense, you create a parliament where you say you come together, you sit and discuss things. Not political, not contentious. Like saying that a person from Karachi, a person from Mumbai, a person from maybe Dhaka, what would they talk of? They would talk of weather, they would talk of drainage, they would talk of problems of water supply and whatnot. Have a dialogue. That dialogue is missing. And that is where the problems come in. And countries tend to get exploited by other extra-regional powers. But SAARC is theoretically good, problematic in terms of implementation. other organizations, whether it is IMF, whether it is World Bank, whether it is United Nations, as I said, these are facing a kind of a crisis. You see, IMF and World Bank are fine. I mean, they are doing their work. United Nations is a very different ballgame altogether. The General Assembly sits and discusses, fine. Security Council is bogged down by the key players, the permanent members, initiating their own ideas and pushing their own agendas and restricting others from discussing a variety of things. But that has been a kind of a problem with the Security Council for a very long time. Now, increasingly, people are questioning it because countries are saying that we will take unilateral positions. Americans took unilateral positions, British are taking unilateral positions, Russians are doing, Chinese are doing. So if unilateral positions are being taken, organizations like the United Nations are naturally going to come into crisis. World Bank and IMF still really operate in that sense. Thank you.
So the next question is China trying to deflect attention from domestic problems by pursuing militant nationalism?
Well, yes, that is the argument that I've been trying to make. You see, the argument is something like this. Let me put a little detail to that. Go back to that Tiananmen Square episode in 1989, if I remember the correct year. Tiananmen Square episode took place in Beijing and maybe other cities. A lot of students were massacred, but there was no uprising within China outside of those cities. The Chinese average person did not react. Why? Because perhaps they felt that what the system, the regime was giving them was good enough. They did not want change. There's an uncertainty about change. Chinese have gone through a variety of revolutions. They don't want change of that kind. So if the regime gives you what you want, then you would not resent, you would not revolt. Currently, if you see it, there is a major crisis, an economic crisis. People are literally out of jobs. So the regime has to now ensure that the welfare of the people or the needs of the people are protected. If they cannot do that, the regime comes into crisis. How do you deflect that tension? You deflect attention by saying we are being attacked from outside. You deflect attention by saying there's a threat to national security. And national security threat is from where? Classic threat, Americans. You do not use the word American imperialism now because that is outdated, but you say Americans. You say Japan. You say South China Sea, we want to do something, they are coming in and they are doing something. You say India. Therefore, you talk of militant nationalism. So militant nationalism is a way to get your people together, divert your attention essentially, get your people together and say that we are under attack, we need to get together, sacrifice yourself if necessary. And Chinese are good at mobilization. One of the key aspects about China is the ability to mobilize. So they're mobilizing people now for a cause of national security. China also initiated a thorough reform in terms of military training in China. That is the purpose. And essentially, that is the argument which I've been making. But thank you.
So this is the last question for the day.
Okay.
What will be the scenario of imports and exports in the world and India?
Imports and exports would not really be affected. I mean, as I said, supply chains, supply lines are some things which are going to stay. When I said globalization and nationalism and where do things clash, that is the argument which I was making. That interdependence in terms of manufacturing is likely to continue. The entire revolution which was brought about in terms of transport revolution through the shipping, the container cargo revolution, is something which is going to continue. That trade is bound to continue. Post-COVID, that would not stop. India would also, what India needs to do in this context is to ensure that our port facilities are developed to really accommodate the growing international trade, which is is bound to grow, is not going to reduce. And when I'm saying developed port facility, is not just port per se, connecting facilities from the port to hinterland, whether it is rail or road network, which India has now started to do. That is something which will not change. Initially, there might be a hitch in terms of container cargo movements, but that would continue. The real hitch would be the tourism, in terms of what was being talked of earlier. That might have a problem. But container cargo, and that is the core aspect of international trade, that is likely to continue. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. It was a pleasure having you. Would you like to say something to the audience before you conclude?
Basically, thank all of you. It is a very strange world where I cannot see you and I have to talk. I have to talk to a blank page. But thank you. I presume you have understood what I've said. I presume that you may not have agreed. I mean, fine. But if you have questions, I am open to that eventually also. But again, my thanks to all of you. Thanks also to Symbiosis College for giving me this opportunity to express some of my views. Thanks a lot. Have a nice day.
Thank you, sir. Before we conclude, a gentle reminder to fill the feedback form, whose link is now published in the Q&A box. Filling feedback for both the days is necessary to avail the certificate. Also, attendees are requested to join 10 minutes before 10 for tomorrow's session. The link for the same will be mailed to you by today evening. Kindly check your spam folder in case you have not received the link. Now, before the day ends, I would like to thank our Honorable Principal, Dr. Rishikesh Soman, Sir, Vice Principal, Dr. Suneni Parchure, Ma'am, our Honorable Speakers for the day, Mr. Saring Wange and Dr. Shrikant Paranjpe, for enlightening up this webinar with their presence and knowledge. It was great to have you both. All the faculty members and the administrative staff, and last but not the least, my dear audience. With this, I, Krutasha, officially pronounce the day one concluded. Stay safe and stay home, everybody. Hoping to have you all tomorrow at the very same platform. Thank you.